Hello and welcome to Nikolai's Genetics Lessons. This video going to be about population genetics, and as usual, I recommend you to stop video here, read the questions, choose your correct answers, and when you would be ready, you can run video again and you can compare your answers with my answers and explanations. And here's the first question. Continuous inbreeding can be dangerous for a small population because it can. And here is the three answers to choose from. And answer A, keep the genetic diversity relatively small. Answer B, make the genetic diversity too large. And answer C, increase the rate of mutations. And probably most of you know that close relative matings leads to increase in genetic problems in the progeny. So I think that many people can choose answer C, increase the rate of mutations, but actually increased number of the genetic problems in the progeny, not due to mutations, but due to inbreeding. Imagine situation where we have female here and male, and female genotype would be capital A and small a, and male genotype would be capital A, capital A. So this recessive allele would be defective, but because this is recessive allele, phenotype of this female would be normal. So now imagine that this mate produce two offspring. One would be female, another would be male. So this is going to be siblings here, and then we have mate here. I put double bond here because this is going to be a consanguineous mating, and we have progeny here of unspecified gender, because gender here is not important. And what is the probability for this person to be genetically affected with genetic disorder that is homozygous recessive? And in order for this person to be homozygous recessive, both his parents have to be heterozygous, because their genotype is normal, but they should be carriers. So their genotype should be capital A and small a. And what is the probability that this parent would give a recessive allele to this individual? And probability is 1/2, because this individual has, this parent has only two alleles, dominant and recessive. This parent only can give one of these alleles that is both normal. So this is 100% that this parent would give one of the normal alleles. But this parent has 50% chances that he would give one recessive allele. So the probability for this female to be heterozygous would be 1/2. And the same rule applies here. So for this male, probability to be heterozygous also 1/2. And what is the probability that this female would give this recessive allele to their progeny also would be 1/2. And the same rule applies here. Here would be 1/2 probability that this parent would give this recessive allele to the progeny. So what we have here, we can show allelic flow with arrows here, and each arrow means 1/2 chances that this recessive allele would be passed on the progeny. So we can say that here on this maternal pathway for this individual, we would have 1/2 chances and 1/2. So 1/2 multiplied by 1/2, and on the paternal side, and here is the male parent of this individual, we have also 1/2 chances here that this parent would get a recessive allele, and 1/2 chances here that he would transfer this recessive allele or pass to his progeny. So once again we have to multiply by 1/2 and by 1/2. So the probability that this individual would get this recessive allele from both sides would be 1/16. So one chance out of 16. So this is mechanism how consanguineous mating leads to increased number of genetic disorders in the progeny, but not because this is increased rate of mutations. As you see for yourself, increased rate of the genetic disorders when we have consanguineous breeding or close relative breeding would be due to the increased probability that this person would have this gene, this locus, and two alleles would be in homozygous recessive state that can be in normal population, be present in frequency as one defective allele per 1,000 normal alleles. That means that 1 out of 500 people may be heterozygous and their genotype can be capital A, small a. So if we have 500 people, 500 people would have 1,000 alleles, and one of these alleles can be defective. So we can find one heterozygous person per 500 people. And the probability that two heterozygous people would meet would be 1 out of 500 people per 1 out of 500 people. And probability of such event would be 1 out of 250,000 chances. So 1 chance out of 250,000. But it doesn't mean that these two heterozygous people would also produce a person who is going to be affected with this genetic disorder. So imagine that we have one heterozygous parent, another heterozygous parent, and the chances that they would produce progeny who is going to be affected with this genetic disorder would be 1 chance out of 4. So this homozygous recessive individual would be affected, and the probability would be 1 out of 4. So as you remember, in the previous calculations we got the probability that two heterozygous parents would meet, that were 1 out of 250,000 chances. So we have to multiply by 1/4 chances that they would have affected progeny. So our answer would be that normally in normal population where 1 out of 1,000 alleles would be defective, 1 out of 1,000,000 people would be affected with this genetic disorder. And you can calculate even faster. So if we have one recessive allele that causes genetic disorder in homozygous state, we have to divide by 1,000. So one defective allele per 1,000 normal alleles. We have to raise 2 or multiply by itself, and we are going to get 1 out of 1,000,000. So this is going to be probability of the homozygous recessive state that would cause homozygous recessive genetic disorder. So now compare these two numbers, 1 over 16 and 1 over 1 million. So 1 out of 16 and 1 out of 1 million. So as you see, consanguineous mating may increase probability of the genetic disorder very drastically in comparison to the normal mating of two unrelated people. So we can cross out answer C. And we can cross out answer B, make the genetic diversity too large, because we cannot get diversity too large when we have consanguineous inbreeding. And actually with each cycle of inbreeding, like shown here, genetic diversity would be lost, heterozygosity would be lost by 1/2. So after about 10 such cycles, all the progeny would be homozygous in all loci, and such genetically uniform progeny we would call pure line. So correct answer would be answer A, and this is keep the genetic diversity relatively small. Consanguineous mating keep genetic diversity small, and with each cycle genetic diversity would be lost. Heterozygosity would be lost by 1/2 with each cycle. So, next question. If a population has been mating non-randomly for a particular trait, and there is then a single generation of random mating, the effect on the gene pool frequency of that trait would be. You have to assume that there are no other evolutionary mechanism operating, and answer A. Equilibrium, that is no change between generations. B. Continuation of the earlier pattern of evolution. And C. Gradual slowing down of the rate of evolution. Non-random mating, in other words, we call assortative mating. And that leads to that some of the alleles can be increased in numbers and some of them can be lost. And any change in allelic frequencies we call evolution, because evolution is a change. When we don't have evolution, we have the same allelic frequencies generation after generation. So if no change in frequencies, that means no evolution. And when we have non-random mating one generation after another, we always have change in allelic frequencies. Then when we have one random mating between all the representative of this gene pool, that means that in the next generation allelic diversity and allelic frequencies wouldn't change. And as you see, correct answer would be answer A. Equilibrium, that is no change between generations. And answer B, a continuation of the earlier pattern of evolution. It cannot be, because before it was non-random mating, now it is random mating, so we can cross out this answer. And answer C, a gradual slowing down of the rate of evolution. This is also not correct answer, because if this pattern would continue random mating, that means that there would be stability and allelic frequencies wouldn't change from generation to generation. Of course, we have to assume that this population is large enough and there is no other external influences like migration, like new alleles that can arise due to mutation, for example. And we have to assume that fitness of every genotype would be equal. And this is all for today. Thank you for your attention. Please subscribe for my new videos that I post almost every day. Thumbs up if you like this video. Please write your comments, questions if you have any. And see you in the next video. Goodbye.